Hello and welcome to Art House, a Flatland conversation about all things art and cinema. My name is John McGrath. I'm a producer for Flatland at Kansas City PBS. And guess what? I'm also a filmmaker. Joining me today is Michelle Davidson Bratcher and Patrick Ray. You guys, thank you so much for being on the show.
Hi. Thanks for having us.
Yeah, okay, I got these two awesome heavyweights that work together. This is going to be a great show. Patrick, so I'm going to introduce him. Patrick, he's directed 5 features. His latest, I Am Lisa, just premiered at the Boulevard Drive-In, and Art House was there to capture it all. So I got some stuff to show you that later. So, Patrick, thank you so much for being on the show.
Thanks for having me. I'm glad to be here.
And Michelle Davidson Bratcher, I've known you for a long time. She's a producer, she's an actress, and she's an accomplished writer. She's like a triple threat. She's done it all. We've got a lot to talk about because these two work together. So Michelle, thank you so much for being here.
It's great to be here. And we're a big fan of you, John, as well.
Oh, gosh. Wow. That's incredible. Okay. No, stop. Don't say anymore. Don't say anymore. Okay. Okay. So let's talk about you two working together. Like, what's going on now? Like we talked about last night. So, Patrick, tell me about what's going on now with you. And
okay. So right now we are in the process of looking at distribution for I Am Lisa. Obviously, a lot of film festivals aren't happening at this point. We've submitted to several film festivals. Some of them are getting pushed to 2021. So we see an opportunity now to get the film out there, since there's going to be a lull in product. So right now we're looking for distribution, and I think we're very, very close. So hopefully the movie will be hopefully more drive-ins, because we were very surprised by the success of last Thursday, excited about it because it's a horror movie. And when I was making the film, I jokingly said it's my first drive-in movie. So it's appropriate that it's kind of by fate has become this movie that premiered at a drive-in. So so hopefully we'll have more drive-in screenings and some form of streaming in the next few months. And and in the meantime, I've got some short films I'm promoting as well. So
Michelle, what's going on? What's going on in Michelle Davidson Bratcher's land? What are you working on? What's going on?
Well, as you know, I wear a lot of different hats. And so I'm just trying to optimize all of those opportunities while we're stuck indoors, which means I'm writing a lot, which is fantastic. Awesome. Patrick and I are developing a TV series that was based on one of the feature scripts that we wrote a few years ago, and it's been in development, and it kind of slowed down a little bit because of the current conditions, but we're excited to see what happens next with that. I have a new feature script that is a sci-fi that I'm hopeful to my other writing partner, Jeffrey Field, and I hope to get that out to folks here soon. And we, fingers crossed, it could potentially be sold. That's the one. That's the goal, right?
Right, exactly.
So I'm also doing some acting as well. I was just on set yesterday on a feature filming in St. Joe, directed by Jason Hudson. So we're still doing it. And I'm helping Sandra Martin and Isaac Alonghi on one of their features. So we're still doing it. It's just on a smaller scale with much tinier crews and much smaller sets of actors.
Well, that's awesome. So it's so great the two of you work together. And you've done some shorts, but I want to talk about Arbor Demon.
I won't let you do this.
Maybe we have no choice.
That's a great story. And when we were talking about it last night, I couldn't believe you did it and how many days you did it. So let's start with Arbor Demon, the story of that. Let's start with you, Michelle, about writing it. How did this whole Arbor Demon thing come about?
So Patrick and I had written short films together. And have we written another feature? We wrote one right before this.
So.
Yeah. So this one, we just wanted to have a very minimal locations, a really small cast.
I had the dream again last night.
A couple going camping, and they both have some secrets. And then there's this supernatural element at play in the woods. So it's scary, and there's conflict among the newly married couple, kind of what's next for them. So we try to tap into a lot of different audiences. We wanted it to appeal to women. Even my mom, who hates scary movies, she watched it. She covered her eyes like this several times. But we wanted to appeal to a lot of different people. And so Patrick and I just, we write together so well because we genuinely like each other and we have a lot of fun and we make each other laugh. And we usually get off track, but we get back on track. We try to find the best characters and then also the best creature, because it is a creature feature, to be unique And in this case, we took it in a very feminine direction. So if you, I don't want to ruin it for anyone who hasn't seen Arbor Day. But there's a really great, we think there's a really great storyline and lore built around this creature that we just made up ourselves. We just, you know, it's kind of fun when you're making a movie and making up the world and the characters, you also get to make up kind of realities.
That's so awesome. So now she's written this script. You had to adapt it for some locations. Okay, so how did you direct this film, Patrick? And I just want to let everybody know that he shot it in 12 days, okay?
Yeah.
So tell me the challenges directing Arbor Demon. So what was the deal with that?
Right. So it ended up being that we were able to secure financing for the film and shoot it in Charleston, South Carolina. And Michelle and I had written the script to take place in the Ozarks.
Where is she? Where is she?
So we had to kind of change the lore of the creatures to fit the setting that we were in. And it was funny because originally they were like, can you make this movie in 17 days? I was like, sure. And then they were like, can you make it in 15? And I was like, okay, sure. And then I think it was about 2 weeks out before I flew to Charleston. And they're like, can you make this movie in 12? And I'm like, in my head, I was like, no, but it was an opportunity and I had to take it. So yeah, we made the movie. We did 6 days on, 1 day off, 6 days on. And it went fast. And luckily, I had been prepping the film production for a while. And so I had storyboarded out every shot for the film. So we had a roadmap that we could follow and kind of tailor to whatever location we were filming in.
Where is she?
Jake Busey is one of the actors in the film. And I think he was cast maybe 4 days before we actually started shooting.
Wow.
So it was a pretty crazy experience. And we shot in late December. And so one of the reasons why we had to shoot the movie during the day, which originally the movie was shot or written primarily for nighttime, but because of expenses and the budget, we had to shoot daytime. The problem was in the forest, there wasn't a lot of time for the sun to be up. Like, it was December. So basically the sun comes up at 7, and then in the woods, it becomes pretty much unusable about 3:30. So we were hustling to get those exterior scenes shot in the woods, but then we built the actual tent where primarily most of the movie takes place was built on a soundstage, so we could control the light and be a little bit more relaxed. And Michelle was there on set for, I think, the second week of shooting where we were filming on the soundstage. So, but yeah, it was interesting.
You know how to use that thing?
Maybe turn the light on!
Did that lead to the inspectors? How did the inspectors come about? Was that after Arbor Demon? And tell me a little bit about Michelle. Tell me about how that happened and how the two of you worked together. And because this is amazing that people don't realize that this is for network television.
Don't miss The Inspectors, part of the CBS Dream Team. It's epic. Weekends on CBS.
That I'm sitting on Saturday and I'll be like, oh my God, there it is. And I would see your name.
Yeah.
So that was so cool. Tell me about the whole inspectors thing, Michelle.
What's really interesting, because it is a relationship type industry, and you think, well, we're in Kansas City, we don't have any real connections or that pipeline to Hollywood, but the producer on Arbor Demon, Grant Fitch, he became the showrunner on The Inspectors, the CBS show, which is about postal inspectors solving crime. And then there's the postal inspectors, and then there's an intern that's the postal inspector's son. And so there's kind of, you know, it's for a young audience, but also a lot of middle-aged people really seem to enjoy it.
Right.
Because, you know, Grant believed in us as writers and as a team, he brought us on and kind of a trial basis, like, let's see how you do with one script. And then it ended up, we wrote 7 episodes and we learned so much, because it is a procedural, but it has to be consumable by a young audience as well. And which is bottom line entertaining. So it was really fun to play in that world, and those, you know, you're limited in time. But then Patrick was able to direct a couple of the episodes that we wrote, which was very exciting.
Yeah, what was that like, Patrick? I mean, I couldn't believe, like when I would watch it, I'd be like, okay, I know Patrick Gray's directing this episode, but I knew the restraints that you would be under, you know what I mean? Like the certain cameras and stuff. Tell me about, like, that had to be one of the most challenging directing things that you had with this. Did you have reunion crews and everything? What was that like?
And it was funny because it was kind of like a family reunion, because it was also shot in Charleston, South Carolina. So a lot of the same crew members that worked on Arbor Demon worked on The Inspectors. So it was, in some ways, that it was very comforting, but it was a big crew. And yeah, we were shooting 10 to 11 pages a day, which is I thought, insane. But because the crew has been working together for so long, months and months, you're jumping from set to set. They have like, you know, like for instance, the house set is only like maybe a few hundred feet from the coffee shop and all that. So everything's built on a soundstage. Michelle and I had written an episode that took place in a newspaper. That was where one of the postal crimes took place. And so they had built this really cool looking newspaper set just to be used just for that episode. And it was funny because I ended up like we created quotes that were on the wall. And then I like basically like said my dad said the quote, and then like a friend of mine said the quote. It was funny to kind of see that all printed out on the walls and stuff.
That's
but
awesome.
there was a day where we had to get like cover 10 or 11 pages of script. And you know, when you're doing television, you're allowed maybe 2-3 takes and you got to keep moving. So I was very involved with casting some of the supporting characters for the day players for those episodes. But the actors were just pros, you know, they could memorize an entire episode just like that. And so it was great to work with them. And we had a really great Steadicam operator. So he was able to get a lot of coverage really, really fast to get the episode in the can. So,
wow. Yeah, which leads me back to Michelle. You're a professional actress, and we joke last night that you were a journalist, and then you became an actress, and then a lot of your roles were you playing a journalist in these films. But you've done a lot more than that. Tell me about your acting career and how that started for you, and what's some of the cool stuff you're doing now.
Well, I started off as a journalist.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to Kansas City Live. I'm Michelle Davidson.
So I was very, very comfortable in front of a camera. I spent usually, 30 minutes to an hour, depending on what I was doing, in front of a camera live, where you don't get a take two, which I have found helps me once you step on a film set. Because for most recently, I worked on a show called Mindhunter, and David Fincher was the director.
One more thing. Manson is small, like really small.
And we did a million takes, so many takes. But then the makeup artist came up to me and she's like, "You're doing great. We're not doing that many takes." So I was like, "What? This is like, we're doing so many takes." And then I worked right after that on a feature film with Tyler Perry.
DC police are looking into surveillance video from several neighborhood cameras.
And he blocked us out. So it kind of like, we're, you know, you're gonna stand here and we're gonna come up here and we're gonna da da da. The camera's gonna come around, you know, right here. That's when you deliver this line, then you're gonna da da da. And we didn't do any rehearsal like with camera. We just went for it. We did two takes. And then he was like, "Okay, great, moving on." And I looked around and I was like, "Oh gosh, what just happened? How terrible was I?" It was so nerve-wracking. So it is interesting how having that experience as a news anchor and a news reporter helped me find that comfort level on set. Because I think that's the biggest thing for actors that I found, because I'm on both sides of the camera, whether I'm a producer and writer or on the other side as an actor, and I see these other actors, how well they work and how comfortable they are. And that's it. It's kind of just like finding your confidence and taking ownership, even if you have one line.
Bladell is a victim of circumstance.
You're saying it's coincidence that both times pageant girls died, Patty Bladell got the crown.
In this TV show or film, you just bring that, you know, you're like, I know exactly who I am. I know what character I'm playing. And having that confidence really helps, because you can tell when you're on set, and that's when you do a lot of takes, is when someone's genuinely nervous. They have the butterflies going and they just, you know, they get in the way of themselves. Their nerves get in the way of themselves.
So I'm just so curious, what was it like working with David Fincher? Did he lots of takes, right?
Yeah, lots of takes. He was amazing. I think that you, as an actor, you always want to work with the best directors. And I feel so fortunate because very early on in my career, I worked with Patrick, who's one of the best directors. and I'm not lying. I'm not just saying that because he's right over there. But you do, you know, I found that, you know, you want to work with the best people. You want to work with people that have a vision. And so when you're working on television, you don't know exactly who the director is going to be until you get your call sheet the day before.
Right.
And I knew David Fincher was the executive producer on Mindhunter, but I didn't know if he'd be directing me for this particular setup. And so, first of all, he's very detailed. Down, like the wardrobe is very important. He wants everything very tailored. I was playing a news anchor and it was on four different days. So I had four different sets of wardrobe and we spent a lot of time adjusting to make sure everything looked perfect. He has such an eye, you know, the wardrobe had to look very specific. The set had to look very specific. And even though I, there's a part where you can just hear kind of me, like a little murmur of me while the main actors, the real stars right. Of the show are talking. He was very specific even about that. Wanted every word to be perfect. So even if you like turn down the the audio of the main actors, everything I was saying, it wasn't just like that. It was just, and it fit the storyline.
Are not satisfied. They are convinced it is tied to the recent slayings of black children. Mayor Maynard Jackson will update the community and address concerns tonight at a local Baptist church.
It was just such. I have to be honest. Like that was the one time that. I had some butterflies and my palms were sweating and I can't let this director down, you know, and I just want to do such a good job. And you've got a huge crew and you're on the sound stage. So it can be very nerve wracking with a lot of people staring at you, but he was very kind, very encouraging. So once I found that out and he just wanted the best take and he wanted it to be, as perfect as possible.
Last spotted at a rally that was held on the Morehouse College campus. Anyone having information on his whereabouts is encouraged to call the Atlanta Task Force tip line.
So when I walked off set, I was just on such a high, like, can I do more? Wow. Because he was really great. The whole crew was fantastic.
Yeah, and Patrick, the jealousy of money and time to have on a set.
Right, I
know you're doing. You're sitting there. You're saying, "Oh, I get it. I'll just take." And you're like, "But what about what if David Fincher only had 12 days to do all of Mindhunter?"
I mean, and someday I will have that yes. time and free to have that many. Like even with the features, generally speaking. When you're making a low budget feature, you break down a 90 page script into 14 days, just to figure you're going to have to shoot 6-7 pages a day to make it, you know? So you don't have the luxury of doing as many takes as David Fincher, but someday I will have the luxury. But you know, it's one of those things where I do so much prep on the front end that I think that it kind of alleviates some of that, you know, because I like to obviously rehearse with the actors, make sure everybody's as prepared. So then when something goes wrong, you can deal with it. Because I've seen it where if you come in and you don't have a battle plan for the day, you don't have a roadmap, and then for some reason, like police just surround your location, which may have happened on I Am Lisa. Granted, it was not our fault. It was right. And something. So a house got robbed several houses down from our location. And the guy who was on the run with whatever he stole dumped it into the backyard where we were filming.
Oh my
God. I'm in the middle of this. I'm in the middle of one of the kitchen scenes in the movie where the two actors are having like a heartfelt discussion. And all of a sudden there's police everywhere. So I'm like, well, we got to stop filming because I literally am seeing police in the background on some of these shots. So it was one of the things where, you know, luckily we had prepped and we were ahead of schedule and we had worked with the actors. So we had the luxury of getting to stop for a few minutes to wait for the police to leave. So it's just one of those things where for me, like preparation is key. And if you come in with a good battle plan, then there's always going to be some crazy thing that happens that you didn't anticipate that you can actually deal with it. Because if not, it just can derail your entire day.
Patrick is such a planner. Sorry to interrupt.
No, that's exactly what I asked about. The storyboards. Have you seen this guy, the way he plans out a movie? Michelle, that's got to make you comforting as a producer or working with this guy, right?
It's fantastic because you know where you are. The whole crew is on the same page and he has such detailed storyboards. He has such a vision for what he wants. The first time that I worked with Patrick was on the movie Nailbiter. And I was 2 weeks away from delivering my... daughter. Oh, which child was it? My daughter. And so talk about preparation. It was hilarious because I was huge and it was supposed to be like I was pregnant with a creature. And so we had all kinds of weird things that he did. We had like a glove underneath that was like being blown up. So my stomach went like, ooh,
wow,
it looked very,
nice.
Very creepy.
Patrick.
But I genuinely think like if I would have gone into labor at that moment, Patrick would have been like, okay, well, we're going to do this. And we're going to, he would have directed that moment because that's how great he is. And also, you know, when things are like he would, like Patrick was saying, inevitably go wrong. And sometimes that creates like the best moments because you have to be creative. You have to think outside of the box. And he's really great at working with that, especially when you have a limited budget and limited time.
Right.
But he just, you know, so much creativity and since, you know, you do work long hours. I think a lot of people that don't, that just watch a movie and they're like, oh my gosh, that looks like so much fun. I wish I could be on a set of a movie. It is really hard work. But when you can be around people that you genuinely like and respect and you just admire their work, it makes it so much fun.
Yes. And Patrick knows it all starts on the page, my friend, doesn't it? And, you know, and I'm so proud. You wouldn't believe all the props of the actors I talked to of I Am Lisa, because I asked them, so what was it like to work with Patrick? And they just said, he's just was like, literally everyone said they were the best director they've ever worked with. So tons of compliments from your actors. And that had to be fun.
Did they have a lot of cash in their pocket after you were talking?
Yeah, there were a couple crisp 20s, you know, kind of sticking out. So I wasn't sure. But I think you should really take some props for that, because unprovoked, everybody said, you know, and what was it like working with those actors? That was one of the best times you had working.
Yeah, it really was. I mean, again, like it was like hanging out with a bunch of friends, you know, and it was fantastic. A lot of local actors I worked with on this movie, Manon Halliburton.
And that was such a great night, Patrick, you know, all those people.
Hi, guys.
Hi.
The masks are required if you leave your vehicle.
Okay.
Just parking one car in the center, two speaker poles. And if you brought lawn chairs, put those between your car and the screen, not to the side of your car, okay? Thank you. Enjoy the movie.
Well, when I first pulled in, I was a little worried I wasn't going to get in.
We were way back there, and I was just like, oh, crap.
I showed up at a little after 8 o'clock and thinking that, you know, I'll be one of the first ones there. And the line was, I was getting text messages while we were driving in. And they're like, this line is epic. And I'm like, you guys are messing with me, whatever. And then when I pulled in, I was like, oh, dear.
I mean, this is a little overwhelming, to be perfectly honest with you, but I could get used to it. I like it. It's good. Because, I mean, you know, you make films for a long time and you show them at film festivals and sometimes 5 people show up. So it's really rewarding to see this many people show up, you know, and a lot of local actors. The lead, Kristen Baganos, came in from Los Angeles and she's actually here. So you should probably interview her at some point.
I am here for the premiere of our feature film, I Am Lisa, and I am Lisa.
You're going to see yourself on the big screen. How does that make you feel when you see yourself acting?
You'd think you'd get over it at a certain point, but I just somehow haven't. I'm like gonna hide the whole time, like peeking out like this.
What part are you playing in the movie?
I play Jessica.
Jessica.
Yes, I'm the lovely daughter of my mother over here, who is the town sheriff.
Yeah.
And we're not very good humans. I think that's the best way to wrap that up.
Eric should have printed. He should have printed more posters.
I think the timing was great because I think a lot of people wanted to get out of the house and see a movie that was locally produced.
I think it's a little bit inspiring that, you know, through everything that's been happening with the pandemic and all that, that we're still able to kind of like come out on top with being able to showcase our art.
And still social distance because, you know, they could stay in their cars. The weather was perfect. So it was kind of like the perfect storm of good things, I guess, is what I'm saying.
I want to get on the loudspeaker and say, this is a $75,000 movie edited in my basement. Enjoy. And hopefully there's not a lot of kids, because this is it's a horror movie.
But I'll be honest with you, I had a lot of anxiety that night.
No, this is the last one before the actual movie, so.
It is?
Yeah.
Already? Okay.
Because the whole time, when you're showing your film, it's one thing to show a short film because it's over in 10 minutes.
Let's see how that looks on the screen.
They good?
Yeah, I think so.
Oh, thank you.
But if you're showing a feature, the whole time you're thinking, oh God, what if the file stops working about halfway through the movie? Everybody's gonna get mad, start honking their car, you know, honking the horns and stuff. So you can't help it. You think of these things. So then when they don't happen, you're like, oh, that was great.
Look good, sound good?
Yeah. It was weird because when I pulled in, I said, you know, everybody's in line to see this movie that I edited in my basement, right here in this basement. So,
exactly.
So it was cool, and I was, you know, I was humbled by it too.
335 cars.
We beg you to forgive us.
I think I was expecting 200.
Father,
I mean, at the most.
And it was just very exciting. And then you're kind of like, okay, well, every screening after this is going to be a letdown. I mean, I hope not, but you know, you think that because. You know, and it was a good reward for the cast and crew. And I think it was a good shot in the arm for the KC film community, just because they got to see some hard work in front of a big crowd. And everybody's been kind of down the dumps with being locked up in their homes and stuff. So I think it was just a really fun night.
Wow. So in lockdown, Patrick's in his basement editing, and Michelle is in her house writing. That's so awesome. You're still doing your thing. I'm so glad you guys did the show with me. I want people to know about this great duo here and the amazing things that you guys do. So I'm so proud of you, and thanks for being on the show.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. This was fun.
Okay, great. All right. Well, that was it. Thank you for another edition of Art House, a Flatland conversation about all things art and cinema. But I want you to do me one favor. I just want you to watch a movie. Thanks for joining us. Well, that's it. Thanks for watching Art House. To be kept up to date on what's going on, go to our website, flatlandkc.org, and subscribe to our newsletter. Until then, I'll see you next time.